Okay, so let's start with the prayer. Oh God, we need you. We need you. We were singing, Bože, trebam, tebe trebam. We need you. And the moment we think we don't need him, that's the end. You know, we need him. God is life. God is life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that the righteous shall live by faith. We have a life. We believe in God. Thank you, Lord. We need you. And we are aware of it. And we need you even now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, may I ask Bojan? Could you? Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. So Bojan will be translating. So listen, Bojan. You know, you don't have to listen to me. Listen, Bojan. You know, he knows God very well. He knows the Bible very well. So listen to him better than me, okay? And let's start. So I just wanted to speak today about difference between morality and spirituality. It's very important. The difference between morality and spirituality. Because you may see a person who is not a believer. You know, there is a very moral man. He loves his wife. He loves his family. He has a job. He is very responsible. You know, he's paying taxes. He doesn't smoke, doesn't drink. You know, when the fall season comes, he is baking paprika. You know, he's a very moral man. You know, and then you have a spiritual man. And you have a Christian. You know, he has the Holy Spirit. Now he is a spiritual man. Because he was born again, he has received the Holy Spirit, and he is a spiritual man. But maybe this Christian is not baking paprikas. You know, that's bad. Because if you live in Serbia, you know, when the fall season comes, you should do the paprikas. No, but then maybe some people would look at this Christian and maybe he is not living so morally as the unbeliever. You know, there are many, we could say by side, better people in the world than in the church. Yeah, I've seen many Christians, some are smoking. You know, and all they can do other things. You know? And the moral man is by side better. But who is accepted before God? Who is accepted before God? The one who received the Holy Spirit. The one who received the forgiveness of sins. You know, and of course we should grow in our spirituality, in our relationship with God. And you know, then the spiritual man, the believer, you know, when he is cultivating his relationship with God, when he's growing in his relationship with God, you know, he is becoming even moral man. Yeah. But the moral man can never become spiritual man. He is soulish man. Soulish, soul, Dušan. Dušan, yeah. His name is Dušan. You know, soulish man. The moral man is called Dušan. Let's call him Dušan. And the spiritual man could be called Duchovit. I don't know, you know. So there's a difference. And the danger is, because we grew up in this world, you know, this was our teacher. School teachers, unbelieving parents, you know, unbelieving friends, TV, and the internet. They were all molding us and our thinking. You know, people are quoting things from, I don't know, not Facebook now, but what's the new thing?
Instagram.
You know, some Twitter and people are like this. But are they quoting the scriptures? Are they quoting the Bible? You know? So we have to be careful not to bring the morality into church. Moralnost. You know, we have to be spiritual, not moral. And the danger is that some Christians started to live in a moral thinking rather than in spiritual thinking. But God is a spirit which speaks to the spirit. In 1 Corinthians 2. You know, God has nothing to do with the mortal flesh. You know, do you remember who wanted to stone the adulterous woman? The Pharisees, you know, representing the law. You know, they wanted death. And they were angry at Jesus who wanted forgiveness and life. Because in a natural view, you would say the woman was immoral. But do you see the passage? She calls him the Lord. So the most probably it means that she was a believer, she was a Christian. So now you have a group of people who are moral and unbelieving and hating Jesus. And then you have this Christian woman, which was immoral, but she is forgiven. And that's very important. You know, not to live in morality, but to live in forgiveness. Many times people forget about forgiveness in their lives. And they start to look at each other with the moral glasses. Instead of looking at people through the cross of Jesus. And you know, it goes so far that people do not recognize the voice of God. You know, many Christians, they live their life and they say, well, I know God, I know God. You know, I know how to recognize the voice of God and the devil's voice. You know, they say, I know how to tell the difference. Because the voice of God is sweet, and the devil's voice is deep. No, it's not in it, right? So how do we know the voice of God and the voice of the devil or the world, or even of our own soul? You know, actually, Jesus calls Pharisees, and he says that your father is the devil. Those who are bringing immorality, and he calls them, you are from the devil. Because they brought morality to condemn the sinner. But Jesus brings forgiveness and resurrection. There's a big difference. So when you ask people, how do you know the voice of God? You know, some say, well, you know, when I hear the voice of God, I have these nice feelings. When you drink a little bit of rakia, you have also nice feelings. It has nothing to do with feelings. You know, people will say, well, I sit and I feel this like a peace. You know, somebody sent me once 50,000 euros to my account. No, I'm joking, you know, but, you know, but I felt such a peace. I was sitting in the church, and I had such a peace. I was so praising God, because I knew I can buy, you know, new laptop, a new phone, a new car, and a new house, and You see, there can be a false peace. You know, where is the true peace coming from? Through the bloody sacrifice. When we have a peace with God, through the blood of Jesus Christ. So we have to be careful that we do not fall into these moral standards. And unbiblical conclusions. You know, have you ever heard this saying, God helps those who help themselves? God is helping to those. Yeah. Basically, you have to do it, you know, and then you say, praise God, you know. That's not biblical. You know, God helps those who are lost. He came to save those who are lost. Right? He is looking for the lost sheep. Sheep is a Christian, the believer. He's not goat, he's sheep. He is in a sheepfold. He is in a house of a shepherd. Yeah. So he is a believer which is lost. And God goes and finds him and brings him home. Yeah. So we have to be careful not to create our own religion without God. That would be very dangerous. Because many people will say, well, I can tell the voice of God. God would never say, kill. Yeah. Or let's say, murder. Right? Murder somebody. Yeah. God would never say, murder somebody, right? Oh, really? Are you sure? In the Genesis and then in the Hebrews 11, God speaks to Abraham. and he says, go and take your only begotten son. And sacrifice him. What? God says, kill your and they think they know. But then when you open the scriptures, you realize you know nothing as you ought to know. And of course we know that at the end, God's the angel spoke to Abraham and said, do not sacrifice your son. Here is a lamb, sacrifice the innocent lamb. You know, it's a picture of Christ. Do you know that in the Psalms, it says that it pleased the Lord to bruise and kill his son, Jesus Christ? It pleased the Lord. God had the pleasure in killing Christ on the cross. Can you believe it? Because he did it because of love for us. You know, it's very important to know God by the scripture, not by our moral standards. You know, here is a beautiful shift in thinking in the life of apostles. In a book of Acts, chapter 10, and here is the voice of God which comes and speaks to Peter. Who is Peter? He is a Old Testament believer. Yeah, he believes the Moses, the prophets. You know, and then he is in a period when the New Testament comes. Yeah, Jesus is crucified. Forgiveness is revealed to the nations. And God speaks to Peter. You know, he had a dream. And he saw this big sheet, you know, filled with four-footed beasts and wild beasts and creeping things and fowls of the air, in verse 12. You know, knowing the Old Testament, we know that for the Jews, it was forbidden to eat these animals. You know, do you like seafood, shrimps? That's no for the Jews, you know. You know, they're unclean animals. You know, the Srpski roštil, pigs. You know, no for the Jews. And here God says, verse 13, and there came a voice to Peter. Arise, Peter, kill and eat. Wait a minute. How can God say, eat unclean animals when the Old Testament says, do not eat them? That's very interesting. Verse 14, Peter said, not so, Lord. I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. I am pure from this. I will not eat it. And the voice spoke unto him, verse 15, again second time, what God has cleansed, you call not unclean. And of course we know this speaks about the gospel being brought to the Gentiles. To the unclean dogs, which is us, you know, Gentiles. And we have to be careful about, I know God, you know, based on my morality. Because God is the one who murdered his son for us. God is the one who says, they are not unclean, go. And bring them the gospel. No, and that's missions. Right? God came and loved those who are unloved. Yeah. You know what missions is? You know, the moral man would come to Africa. You know, and if he would see the animism, that's like African style of worship. You know, if you would see the witchcraft in Africa, you know, fra-fra dancing. Do you remember how Jesus said, unless you drink my blood and eat my flesh, you have no part with me? Do you know that this sounds like a blasphemy in the view of a Mosaic law? It's forbidden to drink blood. And even to drink and eat human flesh and human blood. Yeah? But God spoke about the sacrifice and the spiritual meaning. But many times he says things that we do not understand. But we can trust him. In Genesis 48, this is a very important passage. Joseph comes to Israel. Yeah. And Israel is about to bless his sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. You know, there will be two tribes later on. And it says here that in verse 13, Joseph took his sons, Ephraim, in his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near unto him to be blessed. Verse 13, 48, 13. Genesis
48:13.
Why did he do it this way? Because he wanted the older son to be blessed by the right hand of the blessing. Prvi sin, older son. Yeah. And in verse 17, and when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. When Israel was supposed to bless the sons, he crossed his arms. And it says here, and it displeased Joseph. He didn't have a joy in it. Verse 17. And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head unto Manasseh's head. Now imagine this, the Israel is blessing his son, and Joseph comes and he wants to lift up the arm and put it on the right one. We have idea how God should do it. We have idea how God should do things. And God crosses his arms and he blesses something else. And then we come and we say, no, God. And we are trying to force God to bless the other son. Verse 18, and Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put your right hand upon his head. And verse 19, and his father refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. You know, God is doing something and we say, God, this is wrong. It should be this way. You don't even know what you are doing. And he says, hold your peace. I know it. I know what I am doing. Don't bring your ideas and your morality into Christianity. Very interesting. You know, once I was dealing with this case, with one occasion, one happening was, there was a woman. It was a marriage. You know, and the woman fell into sin. And the husband didn't want to forgive. The problem was that she was a Christian. And he was an unbeliever. She was forgiven. She was forgiven. In the sight of God, she's forgiven. And he could not receive it. And the unbelieving husband could not receive it. He could not receive the fact that she is forgiven. You know, we read it in the Bible. The Pharisees would like to stone. Oh, what a great example. And then when it happens in your life, you are like one of them. We have to be careful. We have to be careful to know the Spirit of God. Not to be moral Pharisee, but to be spiritual with Jesus. That's very important. So let's study the scripture. You know, that's why we are meeting here every Sunday. That's why we have a Bible school. If you don't have a time, you can listen on the YouTube classes. You know, so let's learn God. Let's learn the character of God. You know, because quoting scriptures means nothing. We have to know the heart of the scriptures. You know, John was leaning on Jesus' heart. Very important. So thank you. God bless you and let's pray. So dear Jesus, thank you that we can learn from the Bible so much. You know, we just ask you to teach us. You know, and we pray if there is someone who doesn't know you yet, you know, that he would make a step forward and say, Jesus, save me. You know, let God come into your life. Allow God to love you. You know, receive his forgiveness on the cross. You know, make God your Savior. He will give you his Holy Spirit. You will be a new creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. And we are slowly packing. We can maybe have a very short debate. And then if somebody is interested, you know, I was promising we will do some barbecue this Sunday, but it's not possible. So if you want, we can go down and we can have a coffee there. We can just sit and talk more about this theme. And so if you are not in a hurry, stay and we go down for coffee, tea, whatever. Okay? God bless you. Thank you.